From Jason, we get a kind of local planning plays a key role in achieving sustainable outcomes. So he sort of started at the end of Sean's talk. Maybe we should have started with Sean and gone to Jason, because it's sort of like, now what do we do? And there we go. But in Jason's piece, that notion of a kind of core principle that is a particular problem of legacy cities, of cities that have lost half their population but are bigger than 60,000. You know there's 59 of us? How about that? 59 legacy cities that have gone through that kind of process of trying to puzzle over how you manage vacant properties. A huge issue for our city, one not particularly well addressed by the family of planning documents that that Jason shared. And I can say that with great kind of comfort, because we wrote those plans, all of them. We wrote the downtown plan, we wrote the waterfront plan, we wrote the park and parkway system plan, and we wrote the comprehensive plan. When I say we, I mean a very large collective, but led by the University at Buffalo School of Architecture and Planning, and with an ethic that planning is a democratic practice and how best to engage. But I look at those and I say to myself, I do them all over again and start from a very different point of entry if I followed Sean's lecture properly. We would think about the ecology in a very different and fundamental way as a basic unit of analysis. There's another reason that I would start over again, not just with those plans, but every one of the 33 plans that are in my resume. I would start over on every one of them and use public health as a basic point of entry. You would think about the decisions you make in a fundamentally different way. You might not do a lot of things differently. You do some, but not a lot. Because the fundamentals were already there, as you heard from Sean, in those early sort of neighborhood, waterworks-centered, Garden City, Radburn plans. A lot of this was there. We didn't use public health as a basic unit of analysis. We didn't organize to know that way. And we didn't use ecology as the basic unit of analysis. We didn't organize to work that way. So in a lot of this, we're getting to the point of how do we think about planning, managed or planned, and how best to then implement. What's the basic unit of analysis? The leverage points that Jason called our attention to, the sort of make or modify the comp plan, make or modify an area plan, make or modify the codes and ordinances that implement those plans, make or modify permits and approval processes. Get in there. Each of those are strategic points of entry. All too often, they're reactionary points of entry. That is to say, somebody proposes, and then we complain. As opposed to, wait a minute, let's put the proposal after the description of aspiration and goal and how that works in participation. That's where citizen planners come into play. And there's one very cynical view of go to the meeting, speak into the microphone, sit down, shut up, go home. Or go to the meeting, speak in the microphone, and I think the term you used was babysit, but stay on it. And that's when difficult conversations that are often contentious become matters of course. You can't put housing downtown. Of course you can't. But it only happens with, and I think maybe we need to keep working on the difference between a good babysitter and a bad babysitter. One you're glad to see again maybe needs to be part of the way we structure it. So a fascinating set of two talks, I think, creating an excellent point of entry. We have with us then municipal planner extraordinaire and critic of municipal planning extraordinaire. All of our panelists, I think, have a deep-rooted conviction that democracy well managed is a wonderful thing. It's messy, it's not easy to do, and seldom is it well managed. And with that, we'll open it up to the citizen planners. Yes, please, microphone. Maybe stand up, tell us who your name, give us your name.
Gotta get rid of the technology.
I'm sorry.
First of all, Sean, thank you for talking almost as fast as I could listen. I appreciate that. My name is Sue Tannehill. I live out in Clarence Center on Tonawanda Creek. And I'm curious about what is if you look at things from an ecology standpoint, or perhaps from the standpoint of each of you, if each of you could weigh in on what's the ideal size for a community that can be managed? 3 table saws is enough for maybe 50 people, but it's not enough for 1,000 people. And in my work, you know, teaching and doing other things, there's a critical size for community. And beyond that, I really can't friend everybody in my neighborhood. Do you know what I mean? So if we really want strong communities, what's the best size for that? And I'd love to hear from each of you.
Bring the mic back.
Well, I'll go for a minimum. I live in Colden, population of 3,000. I deal mainly in the south towns. Populations are 5,000, 6,000, 3,000. These populations of these towns, local governments, are just too small to afford professional staffers, training of the amateur people that are elected to the positions. In other words, you're running governments without any professional backing and help. So my feeling would be, and I don't know what the number is, but 3,000 is too small. I would say you get over to Eden and Evans, maybe 10 to 15,000. You'll begin to see professional planners coming in on the staff. So I think New York and the rural areas are underserved locally for the lack of professional staff help training, and it's endemic. I mean, where I live, I mean, I can tell you terrible things, but it's a very, very serious problem.
So one point of entry to your question is, how do you staff and give professional support to a group?
So in the city, I think I'm going to take it from a slightly different perspective. We're lucky that we're a city of neighborhoods. And so it's, what is your neighborhood? You know, I grew up on the Lower West Side. That's a very specific area. And if you tell us that it extended to Connecticut Street, you know, we'd fight with you. No, we're south of Connecticut Street. But then there's also a sub-block. You know, is it the 2 or 3 blocks around you? And it really depends on what your need is. I think there's a nice example in the University Heights. They have the tool lending library where they have exactly the shared saw. So for that, they have a bigger geography than their 3 blocks of neighborhood. But when you're doing a block club, you want your 1 or 2, 3 blocks. So I think it varies based on what your need is. And so if you're thinking about tool libraries and stuff like that, you need a big geography. If you're thinking about crime prevention and snow shoveling and block parties, you go for a smaller. So it varies based on what the need is of the neighborhood at that point.
Is there a literature answer to the question, ideal community size?
I don't know. I mean, as you're asking the question, I'm thinking that's the most complex question I've probably been presented in a forum like this. And then I was thinking, if you had the answer, you'd be a millionaire, and we'd all be out of work. I mean, the reality is it's not, there's no formula. And so, you know, what works in a large, urban, dense area like the city of Buffalo, where those people in most cases have a preference for that type of lifestyle, and the government can deliver the services in an efficient manner, then that number works. The problem you get into Ron's point and to your point about when you get into the rural communities and everything is so spread out, what I talked about earlier, that sort of idea of economies of scale, goes away. Because people in Clarence has a half an acre minimum for a residential lot. Well, that means every lot has to have 100 feet of frontage. Well, you go in the city of Buffalo and you're talking 30 feet of frontage. So it's, and people in Clarence prefer that. So if you took that and replicated over the whole community, whatever the preference was for what's the most optimal size is going to be dictated by what the zoning code permits. And that doesn't necessarily always make it the optimal outcome, I think, from the way you're thinking about it in terms of service delivery and cost. Yeah. Yeah, well, people is a size question. It's a count. And the reality becomes, you know, in its case of Clarence, probably it's more of a density function because it's too spread out. So, yeah, if you can answer that, let me know, and then we'll find a way to sort of be rock stars with it. I think it's a little bit more complex.
I'll just follow up, I guess, real quick. I mean, I agree. I think it really does depend. I mean, if you're thinking ecologically, everything gets much bigger. Because you can, I mean, because you're talking about then shared ecological resources which cross municipal lines over and over and over again and then get dismanaged upstream and then cause problems downstream. And so there are cases where you find communities actually being created linearly, for example, in some cases along, say, a shared like water resource. And then you have the issues of administration and your ability to really need to be able to, you need a scale that you can actually create an administration that people will pay attention to, or, you know, a developer can come in and just walk all over you, because that's, so I think it really does actually depend. But I will tell you that there was research that was done, you know, at the turn of the century by people like Abercrombie and Mumford that were doing, or not Mumford, but Howard, that were looking at density, particularly in the city of London. And, you know, the Garden City, they were 35,000 people, and that was the kind of the maximum size that he thought a kind of a city could be. The communities, as you noticed, like, they could actually be as dense as you would want them to be based on the neighborhood scale. It's really just about how far people wanted to walk. And so the community was really about how far you wanted to comfortably walk, would have been the kind of the historical answers.
See, up in the corner with the hat. Oh, we'll come back around. And while we're waiting for this one, let me just offer this. There's a book out by Christopher Alexander on the pattern language. Speaks to regions, speaks to cities, speaks to communities. There's a pattern called communities of 7,000 people. And his answer is an unequivocal one, 7,000. But it's not like that's it. And it's not like you don't sub-aggregate it, reduce it to smaller clusters or larger clusters. But he finds the economies of scale at 7,000 to be a good number to work with in the community sense that I think you're introducing, but also, I think, from the perspective of virtually everyone here at this point. Yes, sir.
Yes, my name is Modell Galt. I'm a retired substance abuse counselor from ECMC. I'm still with Salvation Army, though, on Military Road Adult Rehab.
Welcome, and thank you for your service.
Thank you. And right now, I'm community activist, and as someone said outside, you're never retired. But my question is to Sean and to Jason. In terms of Sean, I'm really looking at the displaced population of people, and I was always wondering who was responsible for sprawling, too. But you didn't speak on the issue of from the plantation to the projects, as we call it, in the community. You know, where the decision to make these high-rise for Bernie Green and all these other places and whatnot, and then, or even the Daniel Projects turning into the new situation. And then what happens to these people along with this displaced population that was in these high-rise and these places that weren't really, you know, where you can grow greeneries and stuff like that as we have today. And I guess I can give the question also to Jason in terms of those zoning codes, in terms of who make them and make those decisions. I'm also involved with Ghana, West Africa. And so I've been dealing with the NGOs and the multinationals and corporations supplanting the whole government structure in terms of what's important. And what's important is foreign trade and not so much of the people that's in the area. So I guess the question couples the same thing. What happens to the people, you know what I'm saying, that perhaps are not equally representative, you know what I'm saying? So thank you.
So if we take the theme we started to push on in the morning, a little bit about what's the social equity of the conceits that are being offered in terms of density, displacement, and so forth.
I think the reason that I'm actually pretty politically neutral. I would say I generally align myself on sometimes a geologic timescale and deal a lot with landscape. So I tend to like the woods. The reason I like landscape is it has no bias. It likes everyone the same, generally. So I will say that I find that the work being done, at least within a lot of cities, to figure out how to create communities for people that are being displaced, for communities for the people that were living in projects at one point in time that, you know, housing authorities are actually going through and redeveloping their projects. I mean, I'm from Cleveland and worked a bit on the projects there. We're actually trying to figure out how landscape just becomes a much more important part of all of those projects, because it was never really considered. It was like a mowed lawn and something, and we have a large kind of elderly project in Cleveland that we worked on for a long time that has one of the largest community gardens now in the whole city along the river. For me, I tend to just wield the kind of tool of landscape as the equalizer for me in terms of how to figure out how to create equality amongst people, making sure that everyone has equal accessibility to the natural environment. I guess is my kind of short answer in terms of how to address that in terms of kind of like those populations, at least I think in respect to that. But in terms of zoning.
Yeah, so I mean, the zoning question is an important one, and I believe in social equity, and I will take a political stand. The reality becomes that most zoning codes in the suburbs are intentionally exclusionary. Most older, to Dean Shibley's point about sort of legacy cities that haven't updated their code, were never necessarily inclusionary, because if we think about the way the city of Buffalo developed over time, at its sort of apex, when it was as dense as it was going to be, everything was zoned, and the issues that we had, you know, in the post-World War II era when we had sort of the second great migration north, we weren't thinking about affordability and displacement and those types of things, because we had a fully built environment and we had a code that was in place. And it gets back to my point that I was making earlier, is that municipalities have to recognize that affordability and displacement are issues. And if you're not reacting and modifying your codes and there's no one championing that change, then what we see here is out of the sort of the projects in the city of Buffalo, a lot of those people get displaced when those get close to our worst neighborhoods in the city, right? So they're getting into the neighborhoods that have high demolition rates, high vacancy rates, you know, streets with two or three buildings left on them. And so it's about the policy that gets enacted to react to that. And in cities, it has to be exclusionary. In the suburbs, you're really unlikely, because it becomes so politically charged and so about maintaining single-family residential as the mode of housing delivery, that it's hard to get them to get away from the exclusionary zoning. I would pick on two municipalities in general here, but I'm not going to do that now. Their codes are entirely exclusionary. No, I won't do it.
Next.
It's a different conversation.
You want to take a shot?
I don't.
Nope.
I don't have
one. We got it. All the way in the back.
Give me eggs. Yeah.
I have seen firsthand how...
Tell us your name, please.
Stan Kisnowski. I'm a former government official in the town of Cheektowaga, and I'm also chairman of the planning board.
Thanks, Stan.
So I have seen firsthand your politicians dictate the change in your neighborhood. They control it through the seeker process, through the comprehensive plan, through rezoning, through the planning board, and it's sad because you elect people that have no clue on what they're doing that makes changes for hundreds of people. Do you have a strategy to, first of all, educate people politically on how to bring people into the system that listen to the people? And second of all, do you have a strategy to educate people that if they can't make changes politically, how can they get involved through the planning board meetings, through the town board meetings? Because an average politician, if they see 100 people at a town board meeting, they get scared. And they feel there's 5,000 more behind them waiting to attack that politician. But what's sad is you people never react to things unless there's, you know, take a shooting in a neighborhood. You would never hear from that neighborhood on making change until there was a shooting. Just like development. You don't hear from people until something really affects you. And by that time, it's too late, because the politicians have already gone down the road and they're doing things politically. They're not doing things civically. So those two strategies, I think, are important to your program, to educate people and also to make political changes, at least at a bare minimum, have the politicians attend meetings like this.
You just articulated the reason we started the community planning school process, and we will get into both dimensions of that as part of our concluding work. It's exactly to the point of the difference between civics and politics. And we called it citizen planning school on purpose, because it's not possible to conceive of a citizen without also thinking about the body politic it serves. That it's you're always thinking of the individual and the group that the citizen is a part of. And that dialogue is precisely what you're saying needs to be present through, A, getting in front of whatever dumb decisions might be about to be made, but also being able to forcefully and clearly react to decisions that you didn't get in front of in some fashion. So front end, back end. Okay.
David Hahn Baker, and I'm just wondering, from the perspectives of the presentation that you made and the ones who were introduced to us for you, what do you see as the effect of the variabilities of reality. And things like, for example, the one thing that really intrigues me about New York State is that you have the population of the largest city, New York City, and then the population of the second largest city, Buffalo, which is somewhere in some sub-basement down there. How do you make one set of rules, or you know, that somehow embodies fairness and equity for something this large and something so small? And to put on another scale of the variability, my wife and I have completely different senses of what far is. When I was a kid in high school, I commuted an hour from my high school to my home, whether I took public transportation in Chicago on Chicago Transit Authority, or sat on the Den Rhine Expressway for an hour on the commute. My wife, 15 minutes, basically, was what she's used to here. So for me, if it's an hour away, it has to be over an hour away for it to be far. For her, 20 minutes is far. And we somehow live together, and life is good and all that stuff. But you know, we have these totally different concepts of distance and space, which has to have a big impact on all this stuff. So how do you deal with the variabilities of reality in your thinking?
I don't know. I guess I just I hang out with people that share my. No, I don't know. I think that this really does go back to. I mean, this goes back to your discussion earlier about how things are. I mean, things change. Things are different. We're all different. We have different. We all have different things that we bring to the table in every condition. I think that. But the reason that there are still standards that we derive, like, you know, the walking circle, for example, about what's far, and I think that most of those standards are best management practices for better or worse. I mean, they come with inherent problems always, making generalizations that we then plan from, but then figuring out, I mean, but sometimes we need to make decisions, and so it's an entirely difficult process of figuring out what decision to make that is the most incorporative to everyone, or if we lean towards, I mean, actually, those circles are actually for someone who they're for your wife that can probably, like, a 10-minute walk is as much as someone would want to walk. I actually have no problem walking a mile anywhere. And I'd walk a mile to go to the, like, 7-Eleven to get a Coke. It's no big deal for me. And some people don't do that. And so I think that the process is actually figuring out how the standards are the most incorporative for people. And so at least that's generally what I'm thinking about is, like, how do I, how, you know, if I am in the process of having to create those types of standards, I need to make sure that I am, like, certainly, like, taking advantage of or incorporating the largest group of people that I can, or make sure I'm prioritizing the group of people that's the least represented in that case. So, I mean, I think that that's generally the, like, if you're making plans, that's always the way I guess I'm thinking about it. I don't know. How do you deal with that?
I'll let you guys talk.
Well, let's take the town. I mean, the towns in New York all have the same rules. It's called town law. And the town of Tonawanda might have 100,000 people. The town of Colden, where I live, is 3,000. How do they deal with that? Well, one, the larger hires professionals to manage the process. And down at the local level of 3,000 people, untrained, uninformed, irrational decisions are good enough. But it's the same set of rules. It's just that, you know, that's how they handle it. I don't know.
The one thing that, from a regulatory perspective, is there are a couple different sets of rules. In New York State, there's city law, which the cities have to follow. There's town law. And then I believe there's also village laws. So they don't really treat us all the same. And then they even break down some of their laws to municipalities of over a million and municipalities under a million. So they do a poor job of trying to separate New York City out from the rest of us, but they do try. And then there are a number of cases where the laws are specifically tailored to the counties that are in or surrounding New York City. So they make an attempt at it, and I'm taking it from a purely regulatory standpoint, but it's a, you know, dull knife or an axe where it should be a scalpel.
Excellent. Oh, in the back, in the hands up.
I feel like you could also think about how we have, I mean, even this project here, it to some degree is a product of the fact that, like, New York City makes a lot of money. And the idea of actually putting maybe smart people in really small communities that have the ability to actually pull money from those places that are getting funding or have, like, dollars is probably, again, something that is a good strategy.
From the first two questions and the dialogues around it and then your observations, scale matters. and the regulatory and political processes associated with it, and the state constitution in this case, does differentiate towns, villages, cities, and municipal law applicable to all. All of that stroke of the pen stuff. If any one of you thinks that stroke should go a different direction, then that's a conversation. It's a political activist move, and you organize to change the law. It's just a piece of paper.
I'm John Rath. Do you have cities, villages, towns in mind that are doing it right, that someone could look to say they may not have it perfect, but they're moving in the right direction? I guess it's a general question, but are there any of those?
I'm going to ask Bart to weigh in on that, just based on the communities we've worked closely with and seen evolving with different strategies and approaches through the groups we've worked with.
I thought I was done, but I guess I'll try to answer this. I think that Jason showed an example of East Aurora. I think from a like a suburban community, there's a lot to look at the way that community has developed and really kind of concentrated around its village center. It's no surprise that it's one of the most desirable communities in our region because it has a very walkable, strong core. There's a lot to admire about the investments and the focus that the city of Buffalo is making with the green code. I know we talked a lot about that, but I think it certainly represents first in class in our region. There were some questions about the town of Amherst. The town of Amherst is about to be updating their comprehensive plan. The planning department sought funds from New York State to do it, to really focus on sustainability and smart growth in some of the elements that they're going to be doing. So I think it's going to be more focused in the areas of the town that are more amenable to smart growth, the older parts of town where there is kind of more of a walkable feel. But I think the last thing I'll say is that One Region Forward as an initiative, one of the ways that we try to advance the ball towards a more sustainable region is to lift up best practices. And so we have kind of smaller scale examples on the website where you can look at, best practices in the region for sustainability. And then we have examples of where citizens, hundreds of pictures that citizens took about things that they either really like or things that they don't like.
Thanks, Bart. We have a mayor in Williamsville who is, I think, intriguing as well, who is a graduate of our program. So one approach is to elect planners.
Yeah. Yeah, I would add
to Williamsville
as well. You bet. Just kind of a follow-up along the line. Do you know how Reston has turned out in retrospect?
Reston went through a big period of disinvestment in the 80s, basically, where almost considered tearing down a lot of the like Lake Ann's buildings, but since once they connected it to the transit station, the transit within DC, and also when the freeways all got renovated, it turned out to be a big freeway, kind of like bedroom community for Washington DC. So actually, it's typically every year on the list of most desirable places to live by like Time Magazine. So it's an incredibly, incredibly desirable community now, one of the most desirable communities in the country.
My first employer was an architect who chose to settle in early Reston, and I just visited with him like 2 months ago, and he was describing its achieved full flower, what its original aspiration was, which is you can work and walk in the same community, and a lot of people do. So it was, for most of my tenure, 30 years ago in Washington, a bedroom community, but it has clearly matured to be a whole city in its own right. And it's a classic place where those densities are distributed and clustered, and then the workplace tied to the transit line. So you've got the best of both worlds in some sense. I never thought 30 years ago that I would ever speak positively about the Reston experience. Here you go. It goes to the evolutionary nature of this. Other questions in the audience? Go, sure. Mike?
To the point about who's doing it right, I think if we define it as the process, which is kind of what I was coming at from, and I'm building off of Bart's suggestion about this, the town of Amherst, if you look in your communities and you don't feel like the process and the engagement and the system is working for you, just look at how Amherst does it. They process everything very methodically. All their meetings are open to the public. They're announced ahead of time. They're very engaged with the community. And building off of Ron's point, and this has been one of the things that my engagement with the land use and working, land use and development working group with One Region Forward is, to Ron's point, we lack planning technical capacity in our suburbs and rural communities, period. The county used to provide that, but the suburban communities are racing to the bottom with their taxes. They don't want to make that investment. The county cuts planning staff that they used to provide some technical ability to the suburban communities. They're not doing that anymore. So it's really, really hard unless you want to go to your town supervisor and say, we need to hire a planning staff, which is going to cost us money, but we feel the value of it. I would champion, from that perspective, getting that staffer and getting it to be a little bit less political and the decision-making a little bit more community-based.
Yeah, and why can't the towns hire circuit riding planners? Have four or five of the small towns, 3,000 people each, hire one guy, he spends a few days each month in the towns. It's a circuitous route, but I think this Citizens Planning School is going to have an impact in the south towns, in that Bart and company has collected 160, and it's on their website. If you haven't looked at it, go look. 160 plans in Erie County and Niagara County. Every one of the south towns in Erie County have a plan, a master plan. The problem is most of them are filed away in some drawer, and they're never used for the decision-making process. Now, Bart's put them on the website. I intend in my small town civics website to start bringing these up one by one, city by city, and doing an analysis of the plan and sort of prodding the town, saying, hey, what have you done with this plan in the last 5 years? Are you using it when you make decisions on zoning? Are you using it when you do this and you do that? The answer in many, many cases is no, they don't. And I'm hoping that a little bit of sunlight on these plans that are now available on the internet can move people in the right direction.
Excellent. Thank you. Colleagues, cautionary tale, be careful what you wish for. Some of those plans are old. Many of those plans, when we held them up to the community through this process, we got to kind of roar back saying, what about, what about, what about? And so it is both the plan that's there and the critique of plan that you want to use as a platform to go forward. And I know you agree with that. But it's also the accountability. There's hundreds of thousands of hours of citizen commentary and citizen work embedded in that base of planning. It was Eisenhower who said, it's not the plan, it's the planning that prepares you to deal with all the it depends we've heard on today. Scale, market, sort of scale of ecology necessary to keep the wolves alive as opposed to the butterflies. Where are we with that? The other thing we heard, I think, as part of the orientation in the first session was data matters and data help. And that the kind of what are the dependency variables? How are they supported by data? So why is this different than that? Scale and size of city? Well, because this applies there and that applies somewhere else. That database is also embedded in that website that Richard talked about. And then there's the planning, or Ron talked about, there's the planning capacity question. It's interesting to me that the prosperity plan and the five-county regional economic development council activities invite combined funding applications. And a component of those applications is requests for technical assistance and services. If it advances the intention of the plan has one of its planks, smart growth. That's an umbrella for everything we've talked about today. So within that frame, if you're in a smaller municipality and you need the kind of help that Ron's outlined, start organizing to put the request in and bring the professional help you need to do the work. Then finally, I guess I would argue that where we're headed next in the Citizen Planning School, congratulations, you're all halfway home. You have to take a test on the way out, and I think it's in your packet. But fill out your test, drop off your quiz. It's really a way for us to evaluate ourselves and how to make these as effective as possible. But please do that for us, because we'll tally that up, and that's one of the ways you get your certificate, or in Sean's case, the master's degree in town planning. The other thing is to note that a month from now, on April 18th, there'll be another day like this. You'll remember to bring your lunch this time. It'll have, in the morning, a session that focuses and drills down rather specifically into the guts of one region forward. We'll look at transportation concretely, land use planning, food system security, housing and community development. So we'll have a very focused series of presentations in the morning and a discussion. And then in the afternoon, it's hands-on. You'll get to pull data from and look at the mapping tools and other tools that are actually embedded in one region forward and practice with them, use them as a hands-on exercise. Or conversely, going to your point, there's a community organizing school component. So you'll kind of get to choose, I want the tool, I want to know how to organize, so people who know how to use the tools can use them effectively. So we'll have those two kind of optional spreads in the afternoon on the 18th. Finally, just as a kind of save the date, on May 2nd, a small cadre of you who've signed up for and been accepted into what we call Citizen Champions. And these are the groups that have been doing very specific pieces of work and growing from idea to implementation their programs and processes. We're working with another cadre of those through the class that we're teaching as part of this program, and we'll be providing them the technical support to be able to bring their ideas to a sort of summit conclusion, and we'll hear them presentations of their work and proposals that show you kind of what was last year a very powerful representation of real capacity vested in an individual who then organizes around themselves to deliver something of significance and importance to their local communities. That is to say, at some level, much of this is pretty high level, you know, and you really want to get your feet and boots on the ground and do things too. And that's what that's devoted to. So that's May 2nd for the Idea Summit. So we're now coming to the conclusion of the school. We're going to go from here to a session with just those citizen champions who have gone through that process. And we'll just ask you to meet out here in front, and we'll guide you to the next classroom. We'll have about an hour of organizing work with that group. I thank you for your attendance. I look forward to more. Please turn in your quiz. Thank you very much. And thank you very much. Wonderful. Thank you. Thank you. Nicely done.